He was trying to fool everyone, you know, Vivi's actually from China, not from Taiwan. So that was a very naive and unnecessary move. That was the moment that actually gave me this opportunity to welcome everyone to get to know more about Taiwan.
Local time, everyone. Welcome to Innovative Minds with Audrey Tang. It's a whole new series of video podcasts produced by TaiwanPlus, where I'll be talking with world-class thinkers to discuss game-changing ideas. According to statistics, there are 800 million people in the world experiencing period poverty, and 58% of adult women worldwide consider menstruation to be a stigma topic. Our guest today, Vivi Lin, puts what she has learned and experienced into practice. So please join me in welcoming Vivi and learn more about her journey and how she brought her innovative ideas to life. How much do you know about the idea of period equity? According to statistics, there are 800 million people in the world experiencing period poverty, and 58% of adult women worldwide consider menstruation to be a stigma topic. So it's an important human rights and health topic facing the whole world. And our guest today, Vivi Lin, puts what she has learned and experienced into practice. After years of study in Europe, Vivi returned to Taiwan and initiated a non-profit organization, Xiao Hong Mao, with Red, to raise the public awareness of period equity. Vivi's efforts have won her global attention by being awarded the UK's Diana Award and Diana Legacy Awards in 2021. She was also the very first Taiwanese to receive the honors. So please join me in welcoming Vivi and learning more about her journey and how she brought her innovative ideas to life. So hi, Vivi.
Hi, Audrey. Thank you for having me here.
Sure. As the first and at the time the only student from Taiwan at a UWC, that's the United World College, Maastricht, right? Can you briefly share your international experience with our audience? Any culture shocks you have experienced?
So that was definitely a very special experience for me. Studying at the United World College, you know, living with more than 180 students coming from 120-something countries on an artificial island for 2 years, that's a very unique experience, not just for me, I think for everyone. The time when I was in the Netherlands, I knew there was going to be a lot of challenges ahead of me, but I didn't know it was going to be as tough as it actually was. But the reason why I chose to go to this school was because the first time when I saw the website of the school, it stated United World College is an educational movement, which they believe that education can be a force to unite people, cultures, and nations, and that was for a peace and sustainable future. So that was something that really drove my attention, so caught my attention, and I really think that aligns with what I do believe this world should be like. Mm-hmm. So that's why I applied, and I was very lucky to get a scholarship to actually went to the United World College. At the time, I was in the Netherlands. What I did was, I think I spent like 20% of the time doing the academic stuff. 80% of the time I was doing more of the things, being conscious about what is happening around. And at the time, it was actually the refugee crisis, the European refugee crisis. Mm-hmm. It was back in 2015, 2016. So we did a lot of things working with refugees, and we did a lot of things trying to eliminate discriminations at the time.
Okay. Yeah, recently, Russia's invasion of Ukraine and the refugee crisis it caused has caught world attention, right? So can you share your experience, whether you've visited or actually worked at the refugee camps during your time in the UWSA?
So we actually founded a nonprofit organization at the time. It was called Kunapon. You know, bear me with my Dutch pronunciation.
Okay.
But it basically means bridge in Dutch. And why we founded that organization was because we realized that Maastricht, being a very international city, having a lot of international workers and students because of its location. Mm-hmm. It's very close to Germany and Belgium while it's being a Dutch city. At the same time, it's also one of the most conservative cities in the Netherlands. Oh. So there's a lot of conflicts between the international community and the local communities. And when a lot of refugees actually entered the Netherlands and stayed in the Netherlands, there were more conflicts between, you know, all these different communities. So we wanted to be a bridge that actually connect these communities and to eliminate those conflicts or those misunderstandings that were actually caused by, you know, lack of communications. So I was mainly working with the women and the children in the refugee camp at the time. So what I was doing was basically organizing a lot of events, gathering people to make sure that they do communicate with them each other, and to make sure that we can eliminate the language gap or the cultural gap between different communities. And while I was supporting the women and the children in the refugee camp, I realized something which really shocked me. Was there was once this woman asked me whether we have menstrual products available that we can provide to them.
Mm-hmm.
That was the time I actually feel really embarrassed, because being someone who menstruate,
mm-hmm.
I didn't think of preparing menstrual products for people we are supporting, while we actually thought of preparing a lot of different diapers of different sizes. We prepare a lot of milk powders for, you know, kids of different age groups, but we didn't prepare any menstrual products.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the time I realized that this is something that I wouldn't work on. And this is something that I want people to remember next time when they're preparing all the resources for people who are in need.
So it's not just you who kind of forgot about it. It's everyone in the
Mostly.
Bridge group. Yeah, okay, in the UWSA. So in many interviews, you said that your father said 活着, or be alive, to you when seeing you off at the airport on the day you left for Europe to work at UWC and refugee camps. What did he mean, and how did it impact you?
So that was actually it was a message that my dad told me when I was about to depart. And throughout the whole journey, going mm-hmm. from my home to the airport, my dad didn't say anything.
Oh, that's the only thing.
That was the only okay. thing. So I was kind of shocked, mm-hmm. and I didn't know. I was really confused. I didn't know why he said that mm-hmm. When I first heard it. But after 1 year living in the Netherlands, you know, staying in UWC, that was the moment that I realized that what he actually meant, or what he was trying to remind me. I think definitely one part of it is about survival.
Like stay alive.
Exactly, because a lot of people actually dropped uh-huh. out from UWC because it is a very challenging process. A lot of mental health issues are also exist in the school on mm-hmm. campus. And there were some really sad news happening in the schools as well. So, you know, survive and actually being alive, it's definitely one of the things that my dad was trying to tell me. But I think the second part of it is being conscious about things that are happening around you
mm-hmm.
and being conscious about the voice that's inside your heart. Because I think at the time, maybe, you know, 90% of people want to do something. And if you just drift along with no plans and no, you know, voices from your heart, it's something that can be very easy.
Mm-hmm.
But being able to be conscious about your own voice and what you actually want to make as a decision and being responsible about your decision, it's something that can be very difficult. And I think that's what my dad was trying to remind me or tell me. And I think one thing that I find very interesting is that I realized that it's actually the meaning behind my name as well.
Vivi.
Yeah, because I didn't know why my parents named me this name before until I asked them. The only thing I knew was I had this name ever since, you know, even before I was born. But then that was the time that I actually video called my dad and be like, actually, why I was named Vivi? And then he told me that, oh, it was because they hoped I could be a vivid person and to be alive.
I see. So not just stay alive, come alive as well. Excellent.
Yeah, I think that that's definitely, you know, what they're hoping. And I'd say I'm pretty happy about the experience, and I think I can create a lot of challenges throughout the way.
Cool. So, because we're on the show called TaiwanPlus, and with the slogan, and I quote, Taiwan to the world, as a Taiwanese student in Europe, how do you describe your country to others, to your classmates, to the people in the refugee camp, and so on?
Yeah, this is definitely something that I kind of do on a daily basis, and something that I find very happy and honorable doing, to be honest. So there are a couple of words that I always use whenever I'm describing Taiwan. So democracy, diversity, tenacity. These are the words that I always use whenever people ask me, you know, how's Taiwan? You know, how would you describe Taiwan? And I think one thing that I never avoid talking is the dispute international status that Taiwan has always been in, because I do think that the only way that people can pay more attention to the current situation that Taiwan has been experiencing is to not avoid talking about all these things. And as long as it's a rational and peaceful conversation, I'm more than welcome and willing to talk to people about this.
Okay. Well, Taiwan is now internationally very well known as a thriving democracy. What do you mean by tenacity?
I think, so based on our experience doing advocacy here in Taiwan, I do think that, you know, even though we're constantly being threatened by our neighbors.
Or most dangerous place.
Exactly. But I think Taiwan has been, you know, thriving with our own kind of strategies, and being very innovative can be part of our tenacity as well.
Okay. So you said that you're open to discuss Taiwan's international status with your fellow students and so on. And I heard that there's actually an incident where another student destroyed your locker. Did I get that right? Just to check your passport. But what's on your passport? What happened?
Yeah, so exactly. That was something that's slightly crossing the line. So what happened was there was this Chinese student. He was intending to break my locker to get my passport without my permission. What he was trying to do was, you know, before we redesigned our passport, having the big Taiwan in English on the cover, that was Republic of China on the cover. And then he was trying to fool everyone in the school, saying that, you know, Vivi's actually from China, not from Taiwan. So that was a very naive and unnecessary move. But that actually gave me an opportunity to talk to people about, oh, actually, this is Taiwan. I'm holding a Taiwanese passport. There's just slightly some dispute there. Mm-hmm. And that was the moment that actually gave me this opportunity to welcome everyone to get to know more about Taiwan. Mm-hmm. So in the end, I think it's a positive result. But during the process, it was definitely very tough.
So how many people did this kind of incident reach? What's the impact?
The whole school.
The whole school. Like all those different country representatives, right? Because the school is, as I heard you saying, it's more than 100 different?
Yeah, 126 countries, I think.
So it reached everyone.
Yeah. Wow. A lot of people actually chose to come to Taiwan afterwards. And we've got people coming to Taiwan to do exchange programs. And we got people, you know, brought their families to Taiwan for a visit before COVID.
Uh-huh. Well, also during COVID as well, for the gold card program. But when you said that your fellow students heard about this incident and so on, and decided to learn more about Taiwan, and some of them even moved or temporarily to Taiwan, what's their feedback to you?
I do think that we're very fortunate to live in this country where I don't really find the necessity of needing to promote a lot more about the beauty of our country. Mm-hmm. Because whenever I got friends or, you know, pals coming to Taiwan, most of the time they fall in love with Taiwan immediately without me marketing anything.
Okay.
Furthermore, so most of the feedback that I got is, why do you want to leave Taiwan? And I'm like, I never really want to leave Taiwan. I just went abroad for study.
Right. So you studied abroad for how many years?
For 4 years.
4 years. So two in Netherlands and then?
Two in Scotland.
Two in Scotland. What did you learn in Scotland?
So I major in infectious disease and medicine in Scotland. And I also take part in gender studies in Scotland.
Uh-huh.
That was in Edinburgh.
Oh, cool. So in 2019, you returned to Taiwan?
2020.
Yeah. Okay. So you founded the not-for-profit organization called Xiaohongmao with Red and started this great movement. So did you always want to start this movement from Taiwan, or is something that you can start anywhere but you just miss home?
So I could start anywhere, mm-hmm. but I think starting it from Taiwan has always been kind of like my calling, I'd say, because for me it's always a choice between, you know, you can start it anywhere, but why not start at your home? And for me, starting from Taiwan is really meaningful for me, because I can not only solve the problems that are currently existing in Taiwan, but also I can tell people that we are here in Taiwan and we're all from Taiwan and these actions are here in Taiwan.
So your co-founders are all Taiwanese?
Yeah.
That's awesome. Let me get this. So after someone tried to kind of publicly out you for being from Republic of China by destroying your locker, you de-escalated the situation by turning into an open discussion. Was that intentional?
That was actually intentional. Uh-huh. I think something that we learned from our university experience, basically living with people coming from all around the world with different cultural backgrounds and different social backgrounds as well. We've got people coming from the royal families, but we've also got people coming from refugee camps. And living with them really made me realize that you cannot avoid, you know, disagreeing, but you could avoid conflict. Mm-hmm. So you can de-escalate a lot of conflicts, even though, you know, making it into an open conversation can be something that, you know, a strategy that we can use when you find out that there are disagreements between people. And I think that was also the time that I actually realized that the famous quote, I think it was said by Evelyn Hull, which was, I disapprove of what you say, but I would defend to the death your rights to say it. That was the moment that I realized that that's actually true. Mm-hmm. And that's something that I want to fight for in the rest of my life. Is also, you know, I don't want anyone to ever need to prove their identity, mm-hmm. or something that they believe, mm-hmm. anymore. I don't want to see this happen in the world in the future.
Okay, this sounds like a very wise strategy to live in the most dangerous place on earth. So, but to continue
on
your
taught me.
Right, that's right, tenacity. Right? So, to continue your story in UWC, what else did you learn there?
I think one thing that I also learned from my UWC experience was, I always remember the first day I arrived in the Netherlands, one of the teachers that I really admire told all of us actually. So he said, you guys are here not because you're special, but because you're very privileged and because you're extra lucky. And that was the moment that I realized that actually, I'm actually a very privileged person and I wasn't aware of it. So coming from a lower middle class family in Taiwan, I never thought of being a privileged person. I always look at other people's privilege and being like, I don't have that privilege. Mm-hmm. I have to work extra hard. But then that was the time I actually realized that even though coming from this kind of background, I'm still a very privileged person and I wasn't aware. But I should not be ashamed of my privilege. Instead, I should actually be aware and make the most out of it. Mm-hmm. So that was something that I also learned from my UWC experience. And I think that's something that I try to work on daily basis in my current life.
Mm-hmm. But by making the most out of your privilege, what you did was actually starting a nonprofit and a movement with the branding with red, right? So tell us a little bit about how you started the movement.
So I have always been very interested in menstruation mm-hmm. ever since I got my first period mm-hmm. because I realized that it was very difficult for my mom to even say the word period while mm-hmm. she was trying to tell me mm-hmm. about period without using
auntie, right?
Yeah, she was using the word auntie and that and this. So I was very curious why she couldn't say the word period. But I didn't think of making it, you know, a movement at the time. And until when I was in the Netherlands, realizing that there were actually a lot of people needing menstrual products but did not have the access to it. Mm-hmm. And I also encountered that when I was supporting people and teaching in Lesotho and in Tanzania. And then I went to Scotland and took part in the Scottish menstrual movement. And I realized that this is actually something that we can make it happen in our lifetime. So then being in my dormitory, you know, sitting in front of my desk after a hot shower, didn't even dry my hair, I decided that I want to start something that is highly related to menstruation and eliminating period poverty and stigma in the world. Also in Taiwan, of course, because that's my hometown. And then I just started it. Without a plan, actually.
Wow. So that was when you were still in Scotland.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. And so what made you start it, actually, with co-founders who are all from Taiwan, right?
Yeah, so I decided that I wanted to start it in Taiwan. So I have to find a local team, right? Mm-hmm. So that was the time that I started to look for people who would like to work with me. But at the time, I didn't really have any plans looking for people. So I would say they're all kind of godsends. They're gifts from the God for me because I didn't know them before. And what I did was just constantly sharing, you know, my ideas about making Taiwan a stigma-free society to all the people that I encounter, every friend, and, you know, even just someone that I met at a parade or anything. I started sharing my ideas and all these things to more and more people. And then here comes people calling me saying that, you know what, I want to work with you. And here comes people coming to me and be like, I want to quit my job and work with you. So then we got our first few colleagues in the team. And that's how With Red started.
Mm-hmm. So how old were all of you?
We're all under 30. Oh, no, actually, we've got a colleague that's 30, but mostly under 30.
Uh-huh, uh-huh. Right. And why is that? Do you think the younger generation is less stigma-bound for this topic?
The thing is, we didn't do that intentionally. It just happened. Uh-huh. And we thought about the reason behind it. I think the famous quote about youth being a changing agent. Mm-hmm. Might be, you know, a certain level of truth in it. And I think being young, so like young people have less of a social responsibility, and I think young people are more flexible as mm-hmm. well. So that might be the reason why our team is composed by young people.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So what kind of projects do you actually do?
Right, so some advertising moment right now.
Yes.
So in the past 3 years, what we have been doing is we have been trying to eliminate period poverty and stigma and trying to promote inclusive period education and to promote menstrual equity here in Taiwan. We do this via advocacy, we do this via education and frontline social services. We have actually been cooperating with more than 100 schools coming from all the way from primary schools, secondary schools to universities in Taiwan to try to cooperate mm-hmm. with them to make sure that inclusive peer education is mm-hmm. in the curriculum and to make sure that regardless of your gender, you can participate in mm-hmm. the peer education. And we have also been supporting teenagers, especially so people that are under 18 suffering from peer poverty in Taiwan and across all the cities actually in Taiwan, so including the outlying islands. Mm-hmm. We provide them with free and personalized menstrual products on monthly basis, mm-hmm. and we provide them with self-care and peer education, and also a lot of accompany services. So our social workers work on that. And we've also been... what else did I not say? Okay, we've also been doing a lot of advocacy. That was actually inspired by one of the meme about you.
Really?
So one of uh-huh. the meme was saying that get into your mind.
Yes.
And that was the thing uh-huh. that really inspired uh-huh. us. It's like period is something that's very natural and mm-hmm. you know, highly embedded with our daily life. So why not decorate something in a space or you know, just do a lot of things that are highly connected with people in their daily life. So mm-hmm. that's basically our advocacy work. So we've also done a lot of things on campus, in a lot of university campus. Oh, we've actually opened a course named Menstruation
oh,
in
wow.
National Taiwan University
oh, cool.
last year.
Uh-huh.
Yeah,
so that's... What is the course?
Oh,
teach?
So the course is all about menstruation.
Uh-huh.
It's about looking at menstruation with different lenses. So with a historical lens, with a gender lens, with industrial lens, with commercial lens, with all these different perspectives. And we discuss about period.
Mm-hmm. Wow. So it's popular with all the different majors, different schools
yeah,
within
yeah,
the university?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So 1,500 students
oh, wow.
actually sign up for that. So we uh-huh. had to do a shuffle around to actually make sure that people, you know, can participate in the course.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So if I'm a head of a school or a head of university, in addition to opening up new courses to talk about menstruation more, what kind of support do you want from an institutional head?
So we do a lot of teacher and nurse training as well.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're a primary or a secondary school head of these mm-hmm. schools, mm-hmm. then feel free to cooperate with us. You know, feel free to contact us. And then we can see what we can do in your school. So probably train your teachers and provide you with educational materials. And then we can make sure that you can implement inclusive peer education in your school. If you're a university principal, then... You know, support your teachers to open up a course named menstruation and make the whole process smoother. So then, and also support your students as well, because we've seen a lot of students wanting to have menstrual movements in their campus.
Mm-hmm.
But then a lot of times it's very challenging for a lot of them to do it. They've always told us that it's not been easy to talk to the executive team of the school.
Mm-hmm.
So support your students might also be something that I would like to put it here.
Okay. Like personally come to their rallies or something
yeah.
like that.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Uh-huh. Oh, we've got a professor dressed like a tampon
okay.
from National Taiwan yeah. University.
There
so.
You go. There you go. So behind all these movements, I think it's very unique for a first-time entrepreneur to explicitly choose the non-for-profit institutional type, right? Most of the first-time entrepreneur choose a company. So why did you choose the association type of non-profit?
Right. So choosing to be a non-profit organization was already there ever since With Red was founded. And the reason behind it was because we really wanted to be able to cooperate with both the public sectors and the private sectors.
Mm-hmm.
And we also want to be able to criticize them
mm.
when they do something that's, you know, reinforcing the peer stigma or peer poverty.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So we want to be in that position to be able to do both of these things.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why we chose to be nonprofit and to be more of an independent institute, to more of an independent organization comparing to being in a company or, you know, go into public sectors.
Right, so both working with the public and private sector partners, but staying outside of the supply chain, so to speak. So, but do you partner with private sector, like the tempo makers and so on?
So we do cooperate with a lot of companies who make menstrual products, but we make sure that it's an equal partnership, and we also make sure that we have the rights and the power to criticize them when they do something wrong. And we emphasize on, you know, you cannot force us to have an exclusive partnership with you, because we will also partner with other menstrual product companies if they are willing to cooperate with us.
Okay, so that sounds like a principle to me. Are there other principles or philosophies you would like to share?
I think one of the strategies that we keep on using is the why not strategy. We never really force people to join the movement. We always invite people to join. If they don't want to join, then that's fine. But we will invite them. But at the same time, we constantly ask people the question being, you know, why not be more inclusive? Why not support these people? Why not try this out? So this is something that we always use, not just in our advocacy work, but also in our education works, to kind of, you know, talk to students about why not be more inclusive in your own classroom as well. So this is another strategy.
How would they, as a individual student instead of a head of a school, be more inclusive in their class?
So we've actually got middle school students wanting to set up a box in their classroom, which they can donate excessive menstrual products that they have. And if anyone, you know, in that classroom or even outside that classroom would like to use or need to use, then they can use it for free. And we've also got people who do not menstruate, coming from middle school or coming from high school, telling us that, can I also have some menstrual products with me just in case, you know, my friends or even my family members need to use it at any time? And we're like, that's totally fine. That's more than welcome.
Yeah, a friend in need is a friend indeed. So I heard you telling the story of a middle school student with a kind of extra pad for you. But a pad for you is actually one of your campaigns. And did they know about this?
I don't think they know about it. But they just come up with that, and I think that really aligns with the core values that we kept on, you know, saying in the A Pad for You project. So this project, or you can say this campaign, was inspired by the Be Water idea, because we do think that, we do believe that it's not about who is the person doing it, but about how you do it and about how many people are doing it. So we want everybody to be able to take part in, and A Pad for You is definitely a menstrual movement that everybody can take part in.
So which school or institution did A Pad for You officially start?
So there are actually, right now there are a lot of universities and also secondary schools doing it, but it all started from, so we wanted to do an experimental one at the beginning, and it started from the school that my mom worked in. The reason why we did that was because the first one we actually did it, the box disappeared in 2 hours. Someone collected because they thought that it was something that was left by one of the students in the university. So they wanted to kept it. They wanted to keep it to make sure that if the student comes back and, you know, try to look for it.
Like lost and found.
Yeah. And then so we realized that, oh, you actually have to talk to the people from that school first before you actually put it there. So I started that in the university my mom worked in. And then it turned out to be a really positive result. So more than 70% of the students in that particular college knew about the box, even without us publicizing it. So that means people actually, you know about it and they're willing to share with their friends. And we asked them, how many of you guys are willing to, you know, donate excessive menstrual products to the box? And I think it was like around 30 or even 50% of them. And oh no, it was like more than 50% of them are willing to donate. And 30% of them already used that before.
Ah, okay. Right, so it went viral, like just by itself.
Without us doing any marketing.
Cool. So, like, was your mom on board, like, the day you proposed the idea to her?
So she was kind of like, why do you need to do this? Like, what's the purpose of it? Do people actually need that? Uh-huh. But then we're like, why not do it? You know, why not try it out? If in the end of the day, it's something that's unnecessary, then we just don't do it. Mm-hmm. But if it's something necessary or it's something that people actually need it, then why not do it? So going back to the why not strategy, it was also the strategy that I used to convince my mom, I think.
Okay, so you ask your mom, why not?
Exactly.
And then she went around and did what?
So the only thing she did was giving us the permission to actually put that box in the toilet.
I see. Like promising not to clean it away and put it in lost and found. Okay, so then it caught on with its own life.
Yeah.
Oh, wow, that's excellent. So, the projects such as Pet for You, of course, have won you international recognition, right, with the Diana Award and the Diana Legacy Award. Can you talk to us a little bit about how you got those awards?
So the reason why I got this award is about all the projects that we have been doing in With Thread, but I didn't know that I was nominated because it's all externally judged and externally nomination. So I didn't know anything about it. I knew this award because I heard about it when I was in the UK, but I didn't know that I was on the list until I got that email. So it's called the highest allocate that a young person can get for their social and humanitarian action, which is definitely an honor. I'm very, very honored to actually get that. But the first time that I got it, I was like, this is definitely a scam. Like, it's not. I didn't think of myself
getting
it.
Should I hit reply? Should I click the link?
I literally verified the domain. But then the moment that I realized that we actually got it, that was the moment that I think it was a very touching moment, to be honest, because there's a lot of voices and a lot of comments actually challenged us and criticized the need of doing all these menstrual movements. But the moment that we got that award was kind of something that really tells us that you guys are doing it in the right way. And this is something that, you know, it's necessary to build a better world.
That's really good to hear. So so moving on from the projects you did, do you think, like zooming out a little bit, do you think the situation is currently improving in Taiwan? Are we actually moving toward a stigma-free society when it comes to period?
So I do think that we are improving. We're improving in a very fast pace, to be honest, because I've heard it from our international partners coming from the UK. They said, you know, the UK spent like 10 or more than 10 years doing similar things that we're currently doing, but 3 years and we're already here. So that's something that's very encouraging. And a lot of local governments have been cooperating with us, working on some period-friendly policies in their cities or counties. So I think that's definitely something that should be recognized. And at the same time, I do believe that there's still a long way to go to you know, the end point of being a stigma-free society. But I do believe that this can be achieved in our lifetime.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm very impressed because we talked about your idea a couple of years back at a Asia-Pacific Social Innovation Summit. And at the time, there was just like a couple of mayors trying out the idea. Exactly. But nowadays, all the mayors have publicly committed and actually made them, you know, part of their re-election campaigns or something.
Yeah.
Right. So obviously you're doing something right. But why do you think that the Taiwanese society works so well with your why not strategy? What was your message to kind of your international counterparts?
I think, to be fairly honest, I think we're very fortunate to do our advocacy work here in this society, mm-hmm. because Taiwanese community is relatively more gentle and mm-hmm. more accepting to new ideas. Mm-hmm. I think that's what I have experienced throughout, you know, my lifetime growing up here. But at the same time, I think it was because we did a lot of grassroots movements and actually try to talk to people, even though it takes so much time, but we still try as much as we can to go to the public and talk to them. Mm-hmm. I think this is another strategy that we have been using. Another thing that we have been using is we have been trying really hard to catch public's attention mm-hmm. before we go on to lobbying with lawmakers. Mm-hmm. Because we know that in a democratic society, people do value a lot about, you know, what the public thinks. If they think this is the right thing to do, then we probably will have to or need to do it. So we've been doing a lot of things on the internet at the beginning, trying to catch public's attention with memes, with a lot of infographics, mm-hmm. A lot of things that people would find interesting sharing with your friends at the beginning. So that's also something that we have been sharing with our international partners. And one of the things that we have always been doing is sharing and asking people's advice. Even though starting from, you know, the very beginning, when we had just a small project, we were like, why not talk to people about what we want to do and why not ask people's advice? So that was also something that we have been doing.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Right. So to recap a little bit, what it sounds like that you not only have the tenacity to connect to existing social sector and grassroots movements and so on, but you essentially out-memed the resistance by creating just plainly fun memes that people just organically share. So I've been saying this to our international counterparts. This is the Taiwan model, right? Where we just out-meme the resistance, or we are the resistance. So what's your take on the concept of Taiwan model of amplifying like local social innovations into national or even international scale?
So I do believe that you know, all the experience are valuable. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, whenever we share the stories about our Taiwan model, mm-hmm. we always tell people that you still have to, when you're trying to implement that into your local community, mm-hmm. make sure that you include people from your local community, not just implement the whole Taiwan model mm-hmm. in your own community. But you know, be more active and be willing to share. It's something that we also incorporate in our Taiwan model is mm-hmm. we love sharing.
Yeah.
Like, we don't mind sharing and we don't mind everybody doing the same thing, you know, just like what we have
been doing.
Exactly. Because the only way that you can change the world is having, you know, doing small changes in everybody's life and then assemble all these small changes in our lives. It can make it into a big change in our society.
Yeah, I was just talking to a few public servants in the UK. There was this new local conference, and they said, what would I say to people who said that the Taiwan model to counter the epidemic is too culturally different? What's that kind of resistance? How would you out-meme them? And I said, well, just call it the New Zealand model. Because they essentially followed the same playbook and also to very good results. So what I hear from you is that the be water philosophy is that it's not patented anywhere, right? It doesn't belong to, I don't know, Bruce Lee or someone in particular, and we just want the good ideas spread
exactly.
to the world. Well, that's excellent. Thank you, Vivi. And so, yeah, I think if we dare to dream, I think that's one quote from your book, the whole world is your oyster. Right? And so thank you for coming to the Innovative Minds with Audrey Tang. And for our listeners, check out more information and videos on TaiwanPlus.com. We have a YouTube channel too. So if you like today's episode, be sure to subscribe and share. See you next time. Live long and prosper.
It was actually a really nice experience. So I was actually very nervous when I knew that I was going to have an interview with Audrey. Audrey has always been an inspiration for me. So, I mean, I've talked to Audrey like once or twice at some social innovation dinners, but I didn't think of having an interview with Audrey. So that was a really nice experience. I'll definitely remember this. I think the most impressive part is that Audrey was actually talking to me just like talking to a friend, and I actually feel really casual in the interview. So yeah, I think the whole experience is very impressive. I always think that innovation does not come from the cloud, but it comes from doing things, you know, trying things out and doing things differently. So innovative ways, having this kind of show can really share a lot of stories that, you know, what people have been doing and have been trying out in their own community to the world. So I'm really happy to take part in this. I actually follow TaiwanPlus on Instagram. I got a TaiwanPlus fan as well.
Cool, all right.
I'm Vivi Lin. See you on TaiwanPlus.